welcome once again to EWTN's Bookmark. I'm Doug Keck, your host, our guest author, a regular friend of this program, Anthony DeStefano. This time a new children's book, The Grumpy Old Ox, published by our friends at Sophia Institute Press. Welcome. It's always a pleasure to see you.
Thank you so much, Doug. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Now, we recently did another book on the seed who was afraid to be planted, and also Our Lady's Wardrobe, which has really, really been popular, I must say. But in between that, we also were talking about hell. How do you balance going back and forth?
It's difficult. You know, the books that I write for adults take me a long time to write. They take a year, and it's very slow writing, and it's very difficult to prepare and research. The children's books are a joy to write. They're sometimes hard, they're hard to come up with creative, original ideas, but the actual writing of them is a lot of pleasure, a lot of fun, unlike the writing of an adult book. So when I'm on a break from writing a book for adults, I often have ideas for children's books, and it gives me great pleasure to work on them. And so that's why there's a contrast between the heaviness of the adult topics and the lightness of these children's books.
But you also like to weave in some adult themes into your children's books too, don't you?
Always. I'm very aware that adults are reading these books to children, you know, whether it's the parents or uncles and aunts and grandparents. And it's just important to reach them with a message. We're trying to evangelize everybody. You know, so it's wonderful if a child appreciates a book and learns something from it. But it's also even more satisfying when the adult reads something to the child and they're like, wow, I didn't realize that, or I haven't thought about that in years. So we're trying to reach everybody.
Mm-hmm. Now, the little star, that particular book. Now, was that the first children's book? It's a Christmas book as well. Was that your first children's book effort?
Well, in a way, I wrote that book when I was in high school many, many, many moons ago, but it didn't get published till much later. But it was actually my second published children's book. My first published children's book was something called This Little Prayer of Mine. But Little Star was my second published children's book, but it's the first book I ever wrote. I was 16, but it stayed in a drawer for 30 years.
Well, let me ask you about this. Little Star, your characters kind of sweep. One of my wonderful producer, Lee South, came in and told me the grumpy old ox. I thought she was talking to me. I didn't think she was relating to the fact that she had a book by you. So why did you go from all these nice, friendly characters in all your books? You've got the camel there, you know, Roxy, the ritzy camel, the sheep no one could find, the donkey no one could ride, all these kind, and you end up with a grumpy ox. How'd you end up on that character?
Well, yeah, he is a grumpy ox. He is mean, he is prideful, and you would think that he's not an attractive character. But, you know, grumpy characters can be endearing, too. Think of Oscar the Grouch on Sesame Street. I think children can relate to a grumpy character because children themselves can be grumpy sometimes, especially when they don't, you know, when they don't get what they want, when they're a little bit spoiled. So they can relate to someone like that and take it in a humorous way. Also, this character is a lot, I think, like Scrooge mm-hmm. in A Christmas Carol. And if you remember that character, he was also grumpy and mean and cold and but really deep down on the inside, underneath the gruff exterior, he was really a wounded soul, and he was actually a good person, a generous person. And that's why the transformation that occurs at the end of A Christmas Carol, that's so heartwarming because you see the real Scrooge emerge. And I hope that the same thing is true for this book, that the transformation of the grumpy ox at the end of the story will be heartwarming as well.
Well, it was heartwarming for me to realize grumpy people like me can get less grumpy as we go along. So, you know, what we've done sometimes with these books as well is we show the pictures. Now, the illustrator for this one is Richard Cowdery. Now, you've worked with him before. What other books did you work with him on, and why work with him?
Well, I worked with him on a number of best-selling books like The Donkey That No One Could Ride, The Sheep That No One Could Find, The Puppy That No One Wanted, and the one you mentioned before, Roxy the Ritzy Camel. And a couple more, too. Really, the reason why I work with him is because he's the greatest artist in the world when it comes to painting and drawing animals. You know, and it's not just animals, but in giving animals human expressions and human features. Because, you know, after all, Doug, these children's books, they're not really truly about animals. You know, animals are just a metaphor, a device. They're really about human beings. And, you know, sometimes people will ask me, well, if they're about human beings, if they're about people, why don't you just write a story about people? And the reason is that sometimes I do, but sometimes, you know, adults can be intimidating to children. Adults are, you know, figures of authority, you know, and as well they should be. But sometimes when you want to get a point across to a child, the best way is to use something that's not intimidating. And animals are adorable, and they're cute, and they're warm, and a child is never intimidated by an animal.
They're approachable, as you're saying, really.
Yeah, they're approachable, and that makes the whole book more approachable, and they're able to receive a lesson in more of an enjoyable way, and I think that makes a more profound impact on them.
Now, one of the things we've also done sometimes in the past is you've actually produced yourself reading the book, and we've run those on the network as interstitials. And also, in the last Bookmark, we thought that worked well, and it was a great way for people to appreciate the book. And so we're going to take a look right now at you reading The Grumpy Old Ox.
The Grumpy Old Ox, written by Anthony DeStefano, illustrated by Richard Cowdrey. There once was an ox, grumpy and old, blind as a bat, selfish and cold. Prideful and lame, with tired old bones, he lived in a stable, depressed and alone. Without any family and no friends in sight, he stayed by himself from morning till night. His master, like him, was stubborn and vain. He owned a small inn where visitors came. He gave the ox orders, the ox disobeyed. Defiant and willful, he wasn't afraid. The man took a broom and with a loud smack, he gave the old ox a whack on his back. You lazy and sightless and smelly old brute, the innkeeper shouted and kicked with his boot. The ox simply sneered and grumbled with pride. He limped to the stable and lay down inside. The stable was dark, but he didn't mind. He stayed there alone, just bitter and blind. Then, one black night, a door opened wide. A man and a woman were standing outside. The owner was with them. He said with a grin, "You'll have to stay here. No room at my inn." The ox strained his eyes, attempting to see. He barely detected the forms of all three. The lady was pregnant and heavy with child. The man held her hand and tenderly smiled. He put a small blanket on top of the dirt. The woman lay down, about to give birth. The innkeeper left them all cold and alone, without any food and so far from home. But something odd happened that memorable night, something that gave the ox quite a fright. A shutter flew open, and in flooded light. A star in the heavens was dazzlingly bright. It made the small stable feel pleasant and warm. In this simple setting, the child was born. Strange as it seems, the ox became sad because the young family was treated so bad. "I'm all by myself," the grumpy ox sighed. "The reason is that I'm so full of pride. But this little babe, so humble and poor, is guiltless and precious and perfect and pure." Just at that moment, he had an idea. He struggled to stand and limped over near the manger he ate from, all filled up with straw, and pulled it across the cold stable floor. He looked at the woman. In ox talk, he said, "Take my straw manger for your baby's bed." He limped to the pail from which he drank water. He picked up the handle and carried it toward her. He put the pail down and said with a bow, "Wash him with this. I'm not thirsty right now." The lady just smiled and patted his head. She understood somehow the things that he said. She bathed her small baby and dressed him in white. He slept in the manger throughout the cold night. Soon shepherds came in, along with their sheep. They knelt by the crib and watched the babe sleep. A donkey and camel came through the door. They walked very slowly and knelt on the floor. Three figures followed. Each wore a crown, each bearing gifts, each kneeling down. "What can be happening? Who can this be?" The grumpy ox squinted. "I wish I could see." He strained with his eyes and thought for a while, then looked at the child and started to smile. "This baby is special, sent down from above. Yes, that's why this stable is so filled with love. That's why these people are worshiping him. He must be from God. He must be a king." The rest of the night, he knelt on the earth, next to the feet of the girl who gave birth. The family soon left to find a new home. With everyone gone, the ox was alone. He thought of the babe, so loved and adored, while he, the old ox, was shunned and ignored. "I'll try to be different," the grumpy ox swore. "I won't be so prideful or mean anymore." He walked to the manger. His hunger was great. He stuck his head in and rapidly ate. Then he felt thirsty and looked over where the babe had been bathed in the bucket with care. He drank from the pail until he was done and soon fell asleep outside in the sun. He slept and he slept and he slept through the night. He rose with the dawn in the soft golden light. But when he awoke and opened his eyes, the ox was amazed by a wondrous surprise. He looked all around, and what did he find? He couldn't believe he no longer was blind. The hillside, the village, the stable, the tree, all that he gazed at was plain as could be. He rubbed both his eyes, then rubbed them again. Now he saw donkeys and camels and men. All that was blurry was now crystal clear. Even the mountains appeared very near. He got to his feet and walked through the field. His leg was all better. His limp had been healed. He ran to the stable and danced through the door. He didn't feel grumpy or old anymore. The ox was so grateful, he started to sing. "It must be a gift from the king. The baby from heaven, it just has to be. I drank from the water, and now I feel free. I ate from the manger, and now I can see." He started to cry and shouted with glee. "I can see, I can see. At last I can see."
And happy to see things worked out pretty well without giving the story away. Another fine reading by our author, Anthony DeStefano, The Grumpy Old Ox. Again, just to mention, it's available through the EWTN religious catalog, EWTNRC.com. Now let's talk about some of the underpinnings theologically that are actually in this book. Now, the manger comes up several times. Why the manger? And what does the word manger actually mean?
Well, Italian, mangiare, means to eat, mangia, as your Italian viewers will know. And people don't realize that there are so many, the whole Nativity story is shot through with Eucharistic imagery. The word Bethlehem, for instance, in Hebrew, means house of bread. Right. Now, that's not an accident. Jesus, who is the bread of life, was born in a place called the house of bread. And because he's the bread of life, whoever eats of this bread will never be hungry and will live forever. Jesus was born in a manger, as you just said. Now, a manger is where animals, stable animals, eat their food out of. Mm-hmm. You know, the straw and the hay is put in the manger, and then oxes and donkeys eat from it. So, again, no accident there. There's never an accident in sacred scripture. God is the author of life. He knows just what he's doing when he writes the book of life. And so when in this book, when the ox eats out of the manger, and when he drinks from the water in the pail where the Christ child was bathed, he's able to experience a miracle, a transformational miracle. And the reason is because Jesus is the bread of life and because Jesus is the source of living water. Mm-hmm.
So almost like being baptized at the same time there as well. And Our Lady plays, as Catholics we understand it, but Our Lady plays a really vital role in here as well. And she's quite prominent, right?
She is, you know, as your viewers just saw, you know, the ox spends the whole night at Our Lady's feet. And it's really because he's trying to help Our Lady that he brings over his manger for the child to lay down in, and he brings over the pail of water for her to bathe the baby in. So he's helping her. And the implied there is that the miracle that happens to him is really as a result of doing that and comes through Our Lady. We don't say it explicitly, mm-hmm. but as Catholics, we know that that's probably what happened because Mary has this tremendous privilege of being the mediatrix of all graces. She dispenses the gifts and the graces that come from her son, Jesus Christ. And that's what happens in this story with the ox.
Right, and many of us come to our Lord in many ways through Our Lady, as de Montfort would talk about it as well. Now, some of the things with dealing with this, you're dealing with anger and other pride is another part of this. And is there a reason you think children need to deal with anger and pride these days?
Well, they always, especially today, you know, children, I think there's never been a time in history where children have been more challenged by this by being brought up in a society that actually encourages them to feel entitled, that encourages them to be materialistic, and encourages them really to be spoiled. It's hard for a child to learn humility. And as you know, humility is really the great spiritual writers of all time have said that the three greatest spiritual laws are humility, humility, and humility. So how do we teach children to learn humility? And I hope that they will see in this book the profound connection between spiritual pride and blindness. Spiritual. Now, people get confused about this, Doug, too, because the word pride, sometimes it's good to be proud. It's good to be proud of your children when they accomplish things. It's good to be proud of your own achievements. That's a good kind of pride. But the pride that the Bible condemns is, in Greek, the word hubris, which means it's your ego. You think you're better than other people. This is the sin of Satan. You know, he said that he would, you know, raise his throne above the stars and be like God. That's the kind of pride that gets you cast into hell. It's the kind of pride that leads to anger all the time. You know, I mean, people who are prideful are always angry because they think their rights are being violated all the time. They have, you know, their rights are being violated. So, and it leads further to alienation because who wants to stay with people who are angry and prideful? And so it really leads to unhappiness. And the corollary here is that humility leads to appreciation and gratitude and happiness and then eventually eternal life.
Now, you always write in rhyme, and this one seems like it was even more of a challenge, I would think, than some of the other books in the sense of telling the story through rhyme. But I also thought it was interesting, as you say here, his master like him was stubborn and vain. And he's the one who obviously owned the inn that Our Lady and, you know, there was no room in, and he put him in the stable. Why did you make him a mirror of the inn owner?
I wanted to emphasize to children and to adults reading the book that this book is about being prideful and vain. I didn't just want them to see it in the ox. I wanted them to see it in the master of the inn. And also, you know, I you know, you could take it various ways why he made them sleep in the stable. But I've always thought that at least comes off as potentially being a little bit mean of the of that innkeeper not to find a room for them and just to put them in a stable. So it seemed like it went with the story, the true gospel story.
Right. And you make the point of his ability to see, and obviously there was a spiritual blindness that was corrected, right?
Yeah, that's the whole meaning of this book, that when Jesus cures people in the gospel of their physical blindness, he's always really curing them of their spiritual blindness first. The ox is blind physically, but that's a metaphor for his own spiritual blindness. And pride always leads to spiritual blindness.
Right. Now, as far as one of your other Christmas books, let's just talk to that since we're coming up on Christmas when the show was airing. And it was The Little Star. And what remind people, what was the message of The Little Star?
Little Star is about the Star of Bethlehem. And he's the smallest star in the universe, the tiniest star in the universe. But on that first Christmas night, the night that our Lord was born, he sees the Holy Family down there in Bethlehem. He sees them in this cold stable, and he wants to reach out and touch them and warm them with his rays. And so he essentially burns himself out and gives himself up, sacrifices himself for the baby Jesus. So that story was really about the true meaning of love, which is self-sacrifice. That's the same kind of love that Jesus showed on the cross by giving himself to us. It's the same kind of love that God showed, God the Father showed, by emptying himself and becoming a human. So that story was about love, whereas this story is about spiritual blindness and humility.
Well, let me ask you, you were 16 at the time. What was going on in your life that led you to write a book at the time, or a story about the star?
I always wondered what happened to the Christmas star. I would read about it in the gospel, and then they talked about this great star, the Christmas star that was followed by, you know, the three wise men or the three kings. Mm-hmm. And I remember asking my father one day, you know, whatever happened to that star? Where is he? Mm-hmm. You know? And my father said something like, he's not up there anymore. And in my mind, I wrote something better than I was able to write at the time. It must have been inspiration from God, because I certainly, at that time, wasn't religious enough or spiritual enough or smart enough, actually, to come up with a story that I'm very proud of.
Right. Well, let me ask you, do you have any other books, especially kids' books first, that are in the works?
I do. I have, you know, a sequel to Our Lady's Wardrobe is coming out.
Okay.
You know, Our Lady's Wardrobe is all about the different titles of Our Lady. And when that book came out, it's been such a tremendous bestseller that people have been clamoring for another book, because Our Lady has so many magnificent titles. So I have a book called Our Lady's Picture Book, mm-hmm, that's coming out around Easter. Also, I have a children's book on St. Joseph called Joseph's Donkey. And finally, I have an adult book that I'm working on right now that's coming out next year, on miracles,
okay,
on praying for a miracle. Because, you know, Doug, everybody needs a miracle, whether it's a health problem that you're having, or a financial problem, or you're having problems with your children. Everybody needs a miracle. And I wanted to write a book on how best to pray for a miracle. Because you can't guarantee getting a miracle, but, you know, you can increase your chances a little bit if you pray the right way and in the right state of mind.
Right. And one of the books we did recently was the one on the travel guide to hell. Let me ask you, how has that book done, and how has it been received?
You know, it's done very, very well, surprisingly. We were wondering about that, because we were thinking, you know, this whole past year, the year of the pandemic, people have been going through hell. And so we were wondering, would anybody be interested in a book like that? But they have been interested, maybe because they've been going through such a hard time. So it's been received well, but it's also been criticized roundly by people out there who don't believe in hell. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of people out there, not just atheists, but Christians too, who don't believe the full gospel message. They just want to believe in a very happy message about heaven, and they don't want to believe that it's possible for someone to choose to go to hell. And that was the whole point of that book.
Have you had any feedback from people who said that in reading that book, you changed their mind on something like that?
Yeah, I've had a lot of letters, and they've been very gratifying. Some people, I mean, I don't want to, it's embarrassing to go over some of those kinds of compliments.
Right.
But whenever I get a compliment like that, you know, the book changed my life or made me see things in a different way. Well, that's the whole purpose. That's the reason why you write books. in order to do that. And I've been very blessed that I've been able to write about the afterlife on several occasions, Travel Guide to Heaven, this book, Hell, a Guide, and I've written on prayer. And I've had a lot of great feedback from people who say that they were helped by the books.
Just before we go, how long did it take you to put together The Grumpy Old Ox?
To come up with the idea, that I played with in my mind for 6 months, thinking about how to get it right. But the actual writing of the story took me a week.
Wow.
Pacing around, picture me pacing around like a dummy trying to think of rhymes. You know, it's quite a sight. My wife thinks I'm a little crazy sometimes.
Right.
But the end result, I'm glad, was good.
That's right. And you're less grumpy. So very good. Anthony DeStefano, The Grumpy Old Ox, published by Sophia Institute Press, available through the EWTN Religious Catalog. And also, don't forget The Little Star, another great Christmas book as well. EWTNRC.com for all the great books available through this program. Thank you so much, Anthony. And thank you so much for joining us on this program. We'll see you next time on Bookmark.